Welcome to CMSC 355. We'll be starting just in about 1 or 2 minutes. I'll give people a chance to get on since I got started a little late. We'll be starting in just a minute or two. Welcome CSMC 355. Just so you know, we're going to be starting in just a minute or two. I'm just giving people a sec to get on the stream because I got started a little late today. So we'll be starting in just a minute.
Open Gangnam Style.
Welcome to CMSC 355. We're going to give people just another couple seconds to get on the stream because I started my stream a little late. And then we're going to go ahead and get started. Just 1 or 2 minutes. Sorry about getting started a little late.
Open Gangnam Style.
Check, check. 1, 2, 1, 2. Can you hear me in the mic better now? All right, we're going to go ahead and get started. Hope everybody's doing good. Today we're going to start talking a little bit about refactoring. Excuse me for a second. I'm getting some beeps in my phone, which may mean that you're trying to talk to me. Hold on a sec. Let me see what's up in Slack. All right, so just making sure that nobody is trying to Slack me as we're here. Yep, okay, cool. Classism today, FYI. I was a little late though. All right, we're going to go ahead and get started. Today we're going to talk about refactoring. Hope y'all are doing great. Now, a few announcements before we get started. For those of you that showed up to class on time, you get these announcements. For those of you that don't, or if you have friends that don't, you may want to encourage them to show up on time because announcements are kind of important. So last week's assignment was on actions and, you know, like setting up automated builds for your project. Let me know in the chat, did everybody feel like they were able to get that last assignment done okay? How'd it go? What'd you think about it? Let me know in the chat how it went. If it was fine, if it was super hard, if it was easy. at least one person saying it wasn't too bad. What do you think of, what do the rest of y'all think? Some unfixable errors. Yeah, it's so one thing I want to say about that project or that part of the project, setting up automated builds, fortunately for you as a developer, is not something that you're going to have to do a lot of, I hope. Usually you'll have like a DevOps guy or gal or somebody that's in charge of the builds. Sometimes that is a developer from your team though, so it could be you. And the good news is you only have to set up that kind of thing once. You know, the bad news is everybody needs to be aware of how to do a good build and also how to set up your build so that it makes sense. Like, you don't want to do a bunch of custom build steps that are really hard to repeat. A good way to make sure that your build works like on a remote server is to make sure that you can build it both on your machine and also on your teammate's machine. Usually if you can get it to build on both of these machines, then getting it to build on a third machine, which is the server, is not too bad. Anyway, that was a little bit advanced in some ways, but it's very important for y'all to have a basic understanding of that. Excuse me. Okay, the next assignment, I haven't released details on exactly what the deliverable, excuse me. I haven't released details on exactly what the deliverable will be in terms of exactly what I want to see, but the next assignment, which will not be due this Friday, but the Friday after, is going to be demo videos. So just a demo of whatever you have working on your current app. There will be other demo videos this semester. This is just the first demo of your app. Of course, it wouldn't be announcements if I didn't tell you guys and gals to commit. You need to commit. Why do we need to commit this week? There's nothing due this week. Well, guess what? Your deliverable next week might have something to do with commits. So you definitely want to be committing this week. You remember, everybody needs to commit at least twice a week, all the time, to your project. Doesn't have to be a huge commit, but it does need to be a non-trivial commit, meaning it does something useful instead of just like updating a text file. So just make sure you commit this week. And I wanted to get your feedback on what we did last time, where we spent some time setting up actions on the server. I wanted to get your opinion. Do you like those demo-based lectures where you see like Android Studio or GitHub or whatever? Or do you find they're too remedial? So do you like to see coding examples of people using Android Studio, things like that? Do you think it's important? Do you love it? Do you hate it? Let me know what you think. It's kind of like power pair programming, but some people don't like pair programming. And just give me your honest opinion. Let me know what you think, because this might affect what we do in the future. Looks like there's 52 of you right here on the stream, and we got 19, 20 responses. So I'm going to give people just another few seconds to get in their opinions, because, you know, I don't want to do more of those if people are really not into it. But it looks like in general those are helpful. So a lot of software engineering is, you know, practical knowledge and learning how to use the tools. One good way to learn how to use the tools is to see other people use the tools. It'd be great if y'all can screen share with each other within the project, but I'll try and do some more of these kind of demo-based lectures too, because it looks like those are beneficial to y'all, or at least you think they are. All right, cool. Thanks for your opinion on that. I also wanted to get your opinion on that in terms of why or why not do you think those are helpful. I wanted a little self-reflection from you. Why or why not do you think watching other people code is helpful? Let me know right here in the chat why not. Is it helpful to see other people code or set up things? Okay, some people are saying things like, I'm a visual learner, gives us a good example how to start instead of going blind. Make sure I'm doing each step the right way, show an example of the lecture expectation, follow along step by step, cements the process. Yep, so one of the things that I think is really helpful is if you are starting to understand kind of what's going on with all this tooling and whatnot, you can see what I'm doing, and it's probably slightly different from what you are doing or have done. And so you can adopt the things that you like, ignore the things that you don't, and kind of find your own style. But it's cool to see how somebody else is doing it, because then you learn the things that are really important, the things that everybody does, versus the things that are maybe not so important. Yeah, so there's a lot of, so, excuse me. This is another great point. If you're trying to learn how to do software development by just reading things, it can seem like super complicated, right? Like a lot of tutorials, especially like the Andrew tutorials, are like a little bit overdone. They want to make sure they give you all of the information, and so, or the correct information, so they give you everything that could possibly go wrong, and we just kind of give too much information. It's really nice to see simpler things and simple walkthroughs, I think, so that you can, again, get the gist of how things are supposed to go without having to read a huge tutorial. All right, what I wanted to bring up to your attention is there are, of course, many streamers online now. We live in the age of Twitch. I would encourage you to check out maybe an Android one or a C# one or a Java one. Not that you need to watch them all the time or become a big fan of their shows or anything like that, but just it's a great opportunity, free opportunity to watch somebody code. And it's just like watching me code, except, you know, these top X people, top 14 streaming channels on Twitch that'll teach you how to learn programming. For sure, they're going to be really good coders. And so they're going to be great people to learn how to code from. It's a cool resource. All right. That's that. Today we're going to be talking about refactoring your code. One thing I want to bring up for anybody that wants to have their code refactored, please add me, David C. Shepherd, to your repository, like fork it, and add me to the forked version. Or I guess you can add me to the normal version if you're brave enough to let me hack at it. And maybe later today during class, I'll take a quick look at your project and we might refactor something. First of all, a quick note on what is refactoring. Refactoring is just improving the code's design in kind of an iterative way by introducing a bunch of small changes. It doesn't change the way the code, like what the code does. It only changes how the code does it, and especially how the code looks in terms of readability and understandability and reusability and things like that. So it's small changes meant to make your code better and better and better. All right, so why would we ever want to refactor? Well, here's what happens when you're writing code. You probably already started to notice this in your project. You know, the first few classes you write, or even just the basic design of the app you make, are pretty good because, you know, you're really being intentional about thinking about these first few things, and you're, you know, really thinking about your object-oriented design. You really have a very nice app starting off. And then there's like a deliverable and you're like, oh crap, we got to get this demo working. We really need to get our rears in gear. And so you stay up all night for two nights, like just hacking on it, just making it work. And guess what? During this time, things go down in the code that are not optimal. Like people make really long methods. They just keep on coding in the same class without, when maybe they shouldn't, maybe they should have introduced a new class. You know, there's just a lot of things go wrong when you're pushing towards a deadline. That's why we don't usually want to do deadline oriented coding. We want to like steadily work all the time. This kind of thing happens when you're rushing. Now, there's a lot of ways you can tell that you might need to refactor. You know, simple things like, hey, there's code that is duplicated. Very slightly more subtle is just when your methods or routines start getting too long, your loops are getting too long, or there's several loops nested within each other. You know, we talked earlier about the consistent level of abstraction. Basically, don't mix low level calculations with high level reasoning. If we have a subclass that, you know, doesn't really use a lot of the superclasses functionality, it may be kind of not the right place to use object-oriented programming. So there's lots of ways that you can kind of have a code smell, which is just something that indicates maybe it's time to refactor. And these are things that you should kind of keep your eyes open for as you're coding. Here is a very simple example of what a refactoring is. So for instance, we have this print owing, like how much you owe, and we have a method called print banner, which apparently prints the banner, and then we have printing the details, right? And first of all, the smells you might see here is that this is two different levels of abstraction. One is here, the other one is here. You might want to extract this print details, do an extract method refactoring, so that now you have print banner and print details both at the same abstraction level, and then the details are hidden here, right, in this new method that you've just created. So you can see it doesn't change what the method does, but it does change kind of how easy it is to read. I would argue that this is easier to read and understand than this. Now, when you start to talk about refactoring, there's been a ton of research on refactoring, almost as much research and thinking as has gone into design patterns. And so there's a lot of work around how to do a refactoring, especially a behavior preserving refactoring, because there's a lot of program analysis that you can do to certify that a certain refactoring was actually behavior preserving. And so you can either have these refactorings done manually, meaning that you actually just cut and paste code and type in some new method headers and whatever, or you can have, as Android Studio has, a lot of built-in refactoring where you can call something like extract method and it'll take the selected lines of code and extract them into a method and replace that with a method call. So there's lots of different refactorings. If you look at Martin Fowler's book, has anybody ever seen Martin Fowler's book real quick before I move on? Martin Fowler, refactoring. Has anybody ever seen Martin Fowler's book on refactoring? Do you know that's a thing? Let me know in the chat. I would like to know whether anybody's ever heard of that. Hello. I can wait. At least one person has not heard of Martin Fowler. All right. Martin Fowler is a well-known writer on computer science-y stuff, along with Kent Beck, another writer. They've written this book on refactoring. You know, it's the book on refactoring. It kind of helped start the movement. It's mainly interesting in the fact that it lets you know that there are lots of different types of refactorings, and it gives you an idea of what is available, like what common refactorings people might do. It's kind of like Design Patterns in that it's just a classic book. So, I want to know, you guys and gals from the class, have you ever refactored yourself? Yes, no, or huh? Let me know. There is 53 of you on the stream, so let me know if you've ever refactored. I'll give y'all just a minute more to get some answers in. I'm curious. I want to know what people's experience is. So far, it looks like most people have not, but some people have refactored before. And actually, maybe some more people have refactored than I was expecting. That's interesting. Don't know about the refactoring book, but you have refactored before. And it's definitely a good habit to get in constantly improving your code. That's great to know that a lot of y'all have actually refactored. That is a bit surprising in a good way. So cool. Excellent. What I want to do now is just take a minute to refactor a student project. Does anybody in the chat, can they give me a URL of one of your projects so that I can just take a peek around and see if we can find something interesting to refactor? Okay, some people slacked me a URL. So I'll probably start with that one. All right. And anybody else that wants to get in the queue, let me know and maybe put your URL up so we could use that. All right, I'm gonna switch to my source tree view, which, actually not my source tree view, where is that view? Sorry about that. Oops. That's not it. Let me find this view. I'm looking for my full screen view. Is that it? Nope. Man, where is this view? Ah, there we go. Okay. So, we should be seeing this in just a, there we go. Can everybody see an infinite cycle of my screen? I think you can now. Let me know in the chat. All right, cool. Now I'm trying to get Android Studio to show up. It is not showing up. That's annoying. Let's try that again. Starting Android Studio. You can see that happening. And you can see Android Studio hiding out somewhere. Where are you, Android Studio? Man. Android Studio is hiding from me. We'll try one more thing to get it on the screen. Sorry about that. There we go. Okay. Now you should see Android Studio. And I'm also going to open source tree because I'm going to need to clone somebody's URL. I'll just make sure everything's going good here. I have this up. All right. So first thing I'm going to do is go ahead and make a new repository, clone, put in that URL that I was sent. I'm going to browse a path, and I'm just going to make a new folder. This is the COVID app, I think it said. And I'm going to go ahead and oops. Is that what it needs? All right, I need to actually get this. So right now I just need to get the right URL. Sorry, I didn't do that before. I will go to, where is that? Right here. Go right here, oops. Accept the invitation and get that code. I mean, get that URL. Now I'm going back to SourceTree to put in the right URL. You can see that SourceTree checks it. When I go to the next tab, I believe. Not found. What the heck? Well, this is going well. Oops. Cindy, I'm looking in the chat. Does anybody see this? Does anybody know what's going down? Why is this not working out? Does this think I... something's going on here with my source tree. Weird. It does not think this is a get URL. I don't know what to do here. Does anybody see anything I'm doing wrong here? This is weird. This is definitely a get URL. And let me just make sure I'm not doing anything stupid. Okay. So that might be an issue. There we go. For whatever reason, now it's working. And we're going to clone. Who knows? Somebody's trying to get me to use the command line. Yuck. Just joking. Command line's great. If you love it, that's great. I'm not a big fan personally, but you know what? I'm not programming every day, all day. And if I was, maybe I would feel differently. So I'm going to look in branches here. And here I see a David C. Shepherd branch. So I'm going to try and check that guy out. Check out branch. And let's do that. All right, so here I am on the David C. Shepherd branch. I'm going to open that in the Explorer just to make sure I'm opening the right place. And now I'm going to go back to Android Studio and open that folder, oops, file, open. I'm gonna put in that location and open everything up. All right, you can see the build has started below. Everything's gonna be building. Let me know if you got any questions here. All right, so now we have started, everything's building. That's gonna take a second. Let's see what kind of code we got in here. Okay, we got some source right here, Android test stuff, main, am I in a weird view of this or something? Here is some Java. There we go. Thank you. Once it builds, you get the proper view. And it's loading. There we go. All right. Thank you, Android Studio. I was wondering why my view was so weird. All right. So I'm going to look at the regular code because I'm not super interested in the Java code. I mean, in the test code. This looks like a very boring file to change. So let's skip that one. As does this. Is something going wrong with my browser? There we go. Okay, so let's see what we got. The code's actually looking pretty good in this one. Too bad. All right, looking pretty good. This is kind of funny, but I don't see any better way to do it. There's a lot of case statements here. So one thing you might want to do, like in general, this is looking like pretty good code. However, I'm seeing case statements, and you know, sometimes you might want to use a, like, what do you call it? You might want to use polymorphism instead of switch statements. For instance, for different classes of things, they'll handle it differently. You could consider that, although, again, this isn't a really big deal. Right there. Another thing that you could do is, so this is update dashboard. You're doing a lot of create here of things. Like, you could, let's just say, you could extract this into little pieces. So this is update dashboard. It gets yesterday. Where is yesterday used? Yesterday's used down here. And where are all these things used? These things are not necessarily used here. That is used there. So I don't know exactly what this is doing other than updating the dashboard. You may consider like chunking this. Like, let's say some of these things were more related than others. You might want to do that. But again, I don't see any really obvious opportunities. Let's see. All right. Not a lot of code there. So far, it hasn't been super interesting in terms of refactoring opportunities. One thing I would normally look for would be, would be really long methods. That's like an obvious thing to look for. So far, I haven't seen any of that, so that's great. You know, you may consider, for instance, extracting here. All right. Here is a potential opportunity. Let's see. All right, so here we are creating a notification channel. All right, somebody's asking me to increase the font size. Let me do that for you. Can you guys read that? Let me know if this size is better for you. All right. So here is something that could be interesting. There is this notification channel that is being created. And where is this past notification channel? All right, I don't know what that past location one's all about, but let's just look at this one. All right, so right now I'm gonna take that right there, and I'm looking to get this notification channel created somewhere else to make this code a little more readable. And this is nitpicking because this code's pretty good, but that's what I'm gonna do. I'm gonna do that. I'm moving that down here. Alright, you can see how I move that down here. Because I suspect this past location channel, again, I don't know what that's used for, but it seems to be unrelated. You could even put these two things together, kind of like this, like that, and then all of this together. There's two things you could do here. You could make this entire thing its own method, and you could say, you know, set up notification channel, or you could create the notification channel and return it, and then, you know, create a notification channel here. Does anybody have a preference? Let me know whether you would like in the chat whether you want me to refactor this entire thing or all but the create notification channel. Let me know in the chat, what would you like for me to do here? Refactor the entire thing or just the part I have highlighted right now? Hello there in the chat. Would you like this entire thing refactored or just the part that's highlighted? Any preferences? Or no preferences? Notification. All right, somebody say an entire thing. So, all right. All right, if we're gonna do the entire thing, we're gonna have to, all right. So here's the thing. Great, thanks for telling me your opinions. I'm gonna show you two different ways to refactor this, and then so the first thing that I would personally do, I would actually not do the entire thing. I would make this a method. Now I like to use automated refactoring because it's, you know, it just works nicely. This would be the extract method refactoring, which is one that I would recommend memorizing the keyboard shortcut because it's super cool. So here you can see, I don't know if you can see that, but it is Control-Alt-M. Control-Alt-M will refactor this, whatever I've highlighted, into a method. So hopefully you guys and gals are ready. I'm gonna hit Control-Alt-M. And it is not refactoring for me, so that's weird. I guess I can just do it here. So normally that Control-Alt-M would have brought this up, and it allows me to have some control over the refactoring that's going to happen. So here I'm going to have the visibility of private of a method called getNotificationChannel. It is not going to have parameters because all of these were already known, I think. And let's do a preview of what this would look like. Okay. So you can see here is a preview of the method that will be added. And here is a preview of what the code will look like. And I'm like, yeah, that's pretty cool. That's what I wanted. And now you can see we have this brand new method called getNotificationChannel. And up here, you'll notice that this is what the code now looks like. Can anybody guess why did I not do the entire thing? Why did I not do the entire thing? Why did I not refactor the entire thing? There is like a rule around this that we've talked about a few times. So, because it's a consistent level of an abstraction thing, right? The reason I didn't, so here we have we create the past location channel, which is very similar to creating this notification channel. Okay? And then we create the notification channel here, okay? Thus, I would like to do the same thing down here of create it and then add it, okay? What's also interesting about that is I could then think about further Like refactorings. For instance, I could say, let's see. Maybe I decided that this I want to refactor. And so now we're getting really like low level. You usually wouldn't refactor a single method or whatever, I mean a single line, but just for the sake of this, let's do this. So I'm going to extract method and gonna call it get past location. So I don't like the name they gave me, past location channel. And I'm gonna go ahead and just refactor it. And I'm gonna ignore that for now. All right, so now my code really looks exactly the same, right? So now I have get past location channel is right here, and then I add it, and then I do get notification channel right here, and then I add it, right? And you could consider now, you could just have a get and add kind of thing, right? So let's see, you could further, I mean, I'm just going to do a manual refactoring now, where I just copy that and I just say, hey, that could go right here. No need to store that in a variable. And I could do the same thing here and put it right here. And no need to store it in the variable. So what I want you to see here is how, actually, what is this guy used for? Okay, he's used there. I want you to see that we had something that was like kind of hard to read because there was a lot going on. And what we have now is a very simple, readable bit of code, right? So we went from code that was like, it was fine. Like, as I mentioned, this code, I had a hard time finding something that was going to be fun to refactor. But I took it, and by trying to make everything look the same, we were able to get this down to really the core of what was really happening here at the same abstraction level. And I would argue that this is perhaps more readable now. All right, so that hopefully gives you an idea of why refactoring is kind of a good idea every once in a while, how it should go. I think we have to now move back to regular, let's see. It's a regular class. Let me get back to that. All right. But hopefully y'all learned a little something there. Let me go get all my views fixed now. It's hard to share a full screen with y'all, so it takes me a minute to get everything back and running like it should. Okay, and now I only need to get YouTube back up so I can see what y'all are saying about me. Okay, we're almost there. And we are there. Okay, so hopefully y'all understood what just went on there. Again, tell me when you can't see the code and stuff, I'll make it bigger. But I wanted to introduce a little bit more coding into the class so y'all can see what's going down. What we're gonna do next time is we're gonna spend some time refactoring our own projects, actually in class. So don't, we're not going to do that right now. I'm going to tell you just real quick a little bit more about refactoring. Okay, so one of the things that is going to happen when you refactor, if you just refactor willy-nilly, actually somewhat like I did, especially at the end when I was refactoring manually, is you could potentially break something. So you could have your system, which is like the code's hard to read, but hey, it's working. And then you start refactoring, and now the code is really nice, really easy to read, but hey, you've broken something. There's a couple different ways to avoid this situation. First of all, always use version control and make sure that you've committed the last version right before you start refactoring so you can always revert to it. Keep your refactoring small, meaning like just do focus on one method or one class or whatever. Do it one at a time. Of course, use your compiler warnings and compilation errors. And run your test after you do a refactoring. Now, if you don't have test cases, refactoring can be a very scary slash bad thing to do. If you do have test cases, it's not scary at all. You just run some tests, they're all passed. And then you refactor the heck out of it, and then you run those same tests again. If you find things are failing, then you know, hey, I've screwed something up. So that's one of the things that tests are great for. They're guardrails when you're doing refactorings. All right, so there's a lot of questions around when you should refactor. A good practice is after you implement every new major feature, or at least like semi-significant feature, you should spend some time refactoring the code that you just wrote. So again, like a major feature, of course, check it in, do the basic test on whether it's working, but then spend some time cleaning it up. So there's really two stages to committing a feature. It's not just make the thing work and commit. It's make the thing work, commit it, maybe step back and work on something else for like a day or less, and then come back to it and clean it up and make sure that not only is that commit before you close that task, make sure not only does it work, but that it's nice looking code that people can understand. All right, so why shouldn't you be refactoring? There are some bad reasons to refactor. You shouldn't use it as kind of a cover for a bad software development process, right? Like you always need to do some planning. You always want to maybe have some UML, even if it's handwritten UML, just to kind of plan things out. You don't want to just like write garbage code and then refactor it. You need to understand that agile approaches and agile software development is not code and fix. It is still like design is still important, thinking ahead of time is still important. We should refactor, of course, to always improve the quality of our code, but we are not just coding and fixing. That is a bad software development model and it doesn't work. As you saw in this demo, there's a lot of refactoring support in IDEs. Android Studio has a ton of them built in there. I personally really like to know the short keyboard shortcuts to a few key ones. Extract method is absolutely my favorite to know the keyboard shortcut for. So when I was coding full time, I knew that one and a few others like by heart so that I could always just, make my code a little bit more readable. Android Studio is great for refactoring. I'm pretty sure IntelliJ in general makes a lot of refactoring support. And Eclipse, at least back in the day, also had great refactoring support. So you're going to find support for this in most modern IDEs. I think Visual Studio would as well. You can see here is a like the refactoring menu for Android Studio, which again you already saw, but it was hard to see because it was a little small. There's a lot of support for things like renaming and extracting methods. And then there's a lot of more complicated things that you could do, like pull members up, push members down, and that's when you have an object hierarchy. The cool thing about these refactorings is they're behavior preserving, meaning they're not going to mess up what your code does. And they're also like you can do and undo them, right? They have undo support. So that's why you might want to do these instead of just doing manual refactoring. Right, so there is a huge, like traditionally there's been an active area of research in refactoring. There's a lot of research that goes on around software engineering. People are still researching it, especially like refactoring for security or for performance. And there's lots of things happening in this research area in case you're ever interested in doing a graduate degree. And that's all I wanted to tell y'all about refactoring, but I wanted to make sure we had just a couple minutes to open it up for questions about refactoring. So hit me up with your questions if you have any. Remember, we're going to probably be refactoring your own code bases on Wednesday during class. And let me know if you got any questions. If you don't have questions, this is the end of the lecture. If you do have any questions, hit me up right here in Menti, and I'll do my best to answer your questions. Hope you all have a great day, and I will see you on Wednesday. hit me up with questions right here if you have any. Right, I'll get to these questions here just right now. All right, will the live refactoring be on our code or another project's? You will need to refactor your own code on Wednesday. So on Wednesday, you will need to refactor your own code, like the your own project's code. I'm sure we can find some issues in your own project's code. So that's what we're gonna use. Good question. Thank you. Hold on a sec. Sorry about that. All right. So somebody's asking, does refactoring count as non-trivial commit? Absolutely. If I could give that a thumbs up, I would. Refactoring absolutely counts as non-trivial commits. Absolutely. Please do it. You will definitely get credit for those kind of commits. How many deliverable demos will there be? Wouldn't you like to know? In all seriousness, the reason that we haven't had our deliverables mapped out quite as much as you as a student would want is I'm trying to make sure that you, the students, learn every part of the software development lifecycle that I want you to learn. And so I reserve the right to kind of switch to an area that I don't think that you're getting enough, like you're understanding enough. For instance, when we did the GitHub Actions and setting up automated builds, we did that because I noticed like hardly anybody had that set up on their project. And so that was something I wanted to give y'all more experience on. How does that relate to this question? Well, we'll definitely have at least one demo deliverable. We may have multiple ones, but we'll definitely have at least one. But I reserve the right to change that to focus on the areas of software engineering that I think y'all need the most focus on. Good question. Thank you for that. What are some of the lesser known pitfalls or downsides to being a full-time developer? I was a full-time developer basically for about 3 years. I've always done a fair amount of coding in my research as well, but I was really just a full-time developer for about 3 years. The good things about it were, you know, it pays well. There's a lot of fun and smart people that work as developers. I mean, not everybody, but there are definitely smart people that work as developers. If you have a product that's actually used, like by real people, like that's honestly pretty exciting to write something that you know people will actually use. The pitfalls are writing code every day can get repetitive depending on what you're doing. What else might be a pitfall? It really matters what culture you get into. So some cultures are really, I don't want to say negative, but you know, they're just like trying to show off and outdo each other in terms of engineering knowledge. And those kind of places aren't fun to work for. If it's a very collaborative culture where everybody's working together and you're all on the same team, obviously that's going to be a lot more fun and kind of a more learning focused environment. So to summarize, I would say, you know, I would look out for what type of company you join, because the culture will affect your experience as a developer. Is refactoring kind of like the coding version of editing an English paper? Absolutely, that's a great analogy. Imagine turning in your English paper without editing it. That's what a lot of people do with their commits, and it sucks, and it leads to bad code. Great analogy. I'll probably use that next time I teach this class. Thanks. When refactoring, how tiny should the responsibility for a single level of abstraction be? How insignificant should each method be? Sometimes a refactoring of 2 to 4 lines into a method seems trivial. I mean, yeah, this is all about how much is enough, right? You want other people to be able to understand your code. You don't want them to have to go to another method. Like, you don't want to have to like go 20 levels of abstraction down to understand what is really going on in that code. So I would try and keep most methods under about 10 lines of code. And that, if you do that as along with a consistent level of abstraction, that will get you about in the right place. So, you know, try and keep each method to about 10 lines of code, at most 20, let's say, and that naturally pushes you to having a nice kind of balance between, you know, details being hidden, but not one line methods. Somebody's asking, what if we fall behind on deliverables? Well, deliverables are really, you know, like if you had some, we had something due last Friday, if you didn't get it in, it's, I mean, that's over. So now just go to the next thing, right? There's enough deliverables in this class that you don't have to like freak out if you miss one. I mean, you don't want to miss one, but it, you can easily still do well if you just focus on the next thing, okay? So if you miss a deliverable, skip it and go to the next one. That's the best strategy, I think. Somebody said, I have the same bottom navigation bar used in multiple activities and switch statements. What was it you said you would redo about that again? I think you said polymorphism. Yeah, I'm just, so if you're, if you see switch statements, let me get the, hold on a sec. I'm gonna get you a reference. Okay, so all I'm doing here is putting a link in the chat for switch statements. Switch statements are fine in some cases. I'm not saying switch statements are like a no-no, but sometimes switch cases are code smells. And we didn't go over code smells in depth, but you know, just switch statements make me nervous if I see too much of them in an object-oriented system, because it makes me think maybe something else should be used. So I just sent you a link. You should check it out and see if your situation fits those switch statement situations, and if so, consider refactoring. Somebody's asking, what if we fall behind on the commits in the project? We'll just start, you know, whenever you're ready, commit. There's no falling behind on commits. Commits are, like, if you're behind on commits, just commit today, right? There's no, like, there's no way to fall behind on commits. Like, if you haven't committed in the past, yeah, you miss some opportunities for points. However, you're not like behind for today. Starting today, if you commit today, you're not behind for today. So with commits, just if you haven't been doing them, just start doing them now. That's kind of the beauty of the class is, you know, you can always just pick it back up and start to regain some ground towards your grade. So if you haven't been committing, just commit today and you'll get yourself back on track. Hope that helps. All right, I think we're running out of questions. Hope you all have a great rest of your day. I'll sit around here for just another second or two.
Yeah.
And, I'll sit around for just another minute or two in case y'all have more questions, but otherwise, hope y'all have a great day, and I will see you on Wednesday. Going for the view that I have in store in my mind, but I know that I'm making it.
gotta get mine.